And I have a very easy job now. Only thing I need to do is to ask you one more time to sit down and to introduce Arthur Larok, the country director of ActionAid Uganda, who will be introducing the Civic Charter and lead you into the session. Arthur, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and good afternoon or good evening, everyone. I'm going to speak on behalf of a steering group that has been working on the Civic Charter for the last 7-8 months. Of course, the journey of the Civic Charter is much earlier than that, and I will be reflecting on that briefly towards the end of my remarks. So a lot has been said about shrinking space. And so the way I've framed my remarks is to ask the question, is the Civic Charter another passing fad, or it's the missing link? And by the end of my remarks, I will, of course, give you a sense of where I stand on this question. So we already had in the morning and the session before break from Thomas that shrinking space is something that to me actually is not new. It's a historical reality. And it's an intentional process. Now, these two important words are critical because sometimes we think shrinking space is something that just arrived. I argue that it's been alive, it's not new, but that perhaps the resurgence that we had Thomas talked about is because it's engulfing a lot more visible players than before. So a friend of mine likes to argue that there are high voltage and low voltage activists. So the low voltage activists are the people on the front line. They have been suffering this problem for hundreds of years, whether during slavery or colonialism. But the high voltage ones are the ones that are interrupted and then the world erupts. So sometimes people think it's a new thing. But quite honestly, it's a phenomenon that has been with us for a long time. It is caused, in my view, by systematic actions aimed at limiting individual and collective rights of citizens and reducing their capacity to determine political choices or development outcomes. The players that are so powerful that are behind this shrinking political space, in my view, are states often acting on the conditions that are set upon them by corporates. Often, that's the situation that we are dealing with. Now, the historical contestation has been and will likely continue to be between power in people against people in power. Harnessing people's imagination and the resolve to resist and challenge injustice caused and aided by people in power is what this struggle to expand civic space is all about. So quite honestly, let's pay attention to what the true essence of shrinking space really is. Is it because Amnesty is closed, or ActionAid is closed, or which organization is closed? I think at the end of the day, it is what these organizations stand for that is affected. So when you close Amnesty in India or in any other country, you just don't close the organization. It's people who are affected. So primarily, this issue is about people, their imagination, and their aspirations. Now, we've heard that civil society activists, journalists, human rights defenders are facing an escalated level of intimidation, harassment, reprisals, imprisonment, and even death sometimes for carrying out legitimate activities. Now, while activists and civil society organizations already fight for their space every single day, everywhere around the world, within their respective countries and communities, our cause will be strengthened when we act together, nationally and internationally. It is precisely for this reason that we believe the Civic Charter that we shall launch today is timely. It therefore adds value to the many actions that are happening all over the world. Like an African proverb goes, alone you can run fast, but together you go far. The struggle against shrinking space is not about how fast you run, because it's historical, it's protracted, it is how far you can go, and you can't go far on your own, even if you go fast. So we already also heard earlier from various speakers that this is a global phenomenon that requires a global response. Shrinking political and civic space is really something that is happening everywhere, like we had. The space for meaningful participation all over the world, from, like we had earlier, repressive, authoritarian, or hybrid regimes to traditional democracies, have been hijacked by interest groups whose agenda is often at variance with the common good. From Ethiopia and the Gambia in Africa, to Russia and Turkey, Hungary and the UK, Guatemala and Brazil, Vietnam, Cambodia, the US and Canada, the problem is just engulfing everybody. So it doesn't matter I'm standing in a particular corner and I feel like that's the problem somewhere else. We are all in this challenge. Civicus and Global Witness have reported, you know, how many activists are dying every year. Global Witness suggests that every single week there are two activists who are being murdered as a result of their standing for environmental concerns. Civicus estimated 156 human rights defenders in 2015 alone. These are conservative figures, actually. The real issue behind these conservative figures is the tragic reality about why these people are killed. Why? For standing for what they believe and for expressing. So you can debate 156 is big, is small, whatever, it doesn't really matter. It is what they are standing for that that should really concern us. Now, so this being a global problem, we need a global response led by civil society, in my view, in their diversity. While we often find ourselves in different and often disconnected spaces and struggles in the public, in civil society, in the political arena or media space, the reality is that we are all in one big hall. Regardless of which space we operate in, we are in the hall. And as we say again in Africa, once you are in a hall, you stop digging. If you are in a hole, just stop digging and start thinking about where do I get the energy to get out. Connecting our individual efforts, we stand a better chance of not just getting out of the hole, but filling that hole completely so that nobody else falls in there. I think this is the struggle that we all have. So it's not about the isolated or the silos that we heard about in the morning panel. It is about collectively how do we get out of this hole. Our collective action at the end of the day is not just about saving ourselves or our organizations. Rather, it is about saving our planet and our common humanity. For as we have noted, civic space, when it is closed, it is the issues we stand for that are blocked. Like Maina Kiai in the foreword to the Civic Charter emphasizes, unless people genuinely participate, the world will be unable to overcome its most threatening challenges, including persistent poverty, growing inequality, violent extremism, and climate change. we need a plurality of voice and action to be able to overcome. So therefore, if there is one reason why we should fight for this space and for this freedom to express, is because we have a role to play and a contribution to make to enable the world to overcome the challenges we face. So let me turn then to the Civic Charter and the essence of the Civic Charter. The preamble of the Civic Charter that all of you already have, it's just 2 pages. Don't think it's this big document. It has some background to it, but it's a very simple 2-page document. We underline the centrality of people's participation as necessary to bring life and give meaning to democracy. I am amazed when I listen to, when I participate or even listen to elections. Now, think about the US, it's the big election now. It can happen in Uganda. How much we pay attention to what politicians are saying and the empty promises they make. Little time do we accord for ourselves to articulate the agenda, citizen agenda that politicians should be responding to. It should be the other way around. Not somebody giving you endless promises, but we as citizens articulating the agenda that we believe politicians have to respond to. Well, achieving all that we desire, building a just, tolerant, and peaceful societies, history has taught us that most social, environmental, political progress in the past have come from people challenging status quo, not from anywhere else. Abolition of slavery is an example. It didn't just come because somebody wanted to abolish. The right to vote for women, organization for labor rights, establishing environmental standards, or the determined struggle by the people in South Africa to bring apartheid to an end. Many people died, but it was a people's struggle. In all these examples, the benefactors were a minority holding power, like Thomas said, not just politicians, but those who hold power. Sometimes hidden, sometimes invisible, and sometimes visible. On the one hand, but on the other, a majority resolved to resist and build a stake in how the world is governed. The essence of the Civic Charter is therefore harnessing the power in people to engage people in power. We had a very important meeting in Arusha in the process of developing the Civic Charter, where we were told by activists that completely changed the direction. This thing is not about saving civil society organizations. It is about people. And so it's very clear in the Civic Charter that this is simply about those in the front line as the primary audience. Of course, civil society organizations are important as organized forms of society, but at the end of the day, it's those in the front lines. We have observed that the Civic Charter is not another whining request. This was by Annabelle, who is part of the steering committee, the chair of Civicus. That it's not another whining request for people to participate. It also brings forth the synergy between rights, guarantees, and principles. If you look at the Civic Charter, the rights, guarantees, and principles are well articulated. But it also demands of us greater responsibility to be publicly accountable. So principle number 10 is about how business, civil society, government are accountable to the public and to people. As civil society leaders promoting this charter, we open ourselves to greater scrutiny. And as we claim greater freedoms and space, we should also remember the responsibility that this comes with. Another proverb from Africa. It reminds me, we have a proverb in Africa that the higher the monkey climbs, the more it exposes its something. Huh? The higher you go, the more you expose. I think the question of accountability within the sector is very important. Very often when we discuss, we think, no, it's a diversion. Of course, governments have used that as an excuse, but there are real problems within the sector. We have to be honest. Unless you admit this and deal with them, we will become part of the problem. We shrink our own space by becoming unaccountable. I think this is an important point. In such a space, I have no apologies to make, because we need to look in as well. Now, as I conclude, let me just share the empowering journey of the Civic Charter. We went through from Bangkok in 2015, I think at the end of the Global Perspectives in Bangkok, I wasn't there, up to Berlin 2016, we've gone through really important phases. First, after taking up the challenge, the International Civil Society Center that took up the challenge to develop this charter brought together a group of 13 representatives from diverse agencies to discuss the outcomes of a survey commissioned on civic space and how this is reflected in different countries, and also to provide thought and right leadership. So we went through conceptualization. What should this civic charter be about? We have UN resolutions, we have progressive constitutions, we have all sorts of things. So how different is the civic charter is a question, is a conceptual question we asked. We articulated the words in the civic charter. Amnesty will know more than anybody else. Every single word in that charter we can defend, because we negotiated those words. It was my first time, you know, to participate. I thought this was for the UN only. But, you know, just coming from, just every single word we debated, this might mean this, it might be looked at. I was like, what is all this about? But now I value that, because everywhere I've shared this, they've said, yeah, you got it right. So the articulation really mattered. Then there was testing. So when we went to Arusha, we got a group of activists. Some of them are here. Gacheke is around from Kenya. And they told us, you are joking. You have to change. You will watch a video where some of them participated, you know. So they gave impetus and really challenged some of the texts that we had earlier. So we were able to test what we were talking about. And it was in Arusha that we were ultimately very clear that the primary audience of this charter are people in the front lines. Then, of course, we are very happy that today we are going to be launching the Civic Charter that we are delighted about delivering. Now, in addition to the consultation process that we went through, several rounds of each time we produced a draft. The first draft was in March. We sent it out, lots of comments online, and that process is well documented by the International Civil Society Center. We also used the occasion to share the charter at the World Social Forum, where our project coordinator, Miriam, attended several sessions in which she shared the charter, and we got input. All this was useful for perfecting what we now have today. Now, with its launch today, we begin another phase of the struggle for civic space, one that places at its center people, locally rooted in their countries and communities, but globally connected. This is important. So the low voltage people should be connected globally as well. I think that's the point. The colleague from India already made that point earlier. But most importantly, the defense of civic space, our best chance is people. So in Ethiopia, it doesn't matter how much global solidarity you get. The ActionAid office in Ethiopia doesn't want you to send a global solidarity because it endangers them more. Two of our ActionAid staff, a number of years ago, were imprisoned. A huge delegation went to speak to the late Melas, and now we didn't help. But the people in Ethiopia should be able to defend the organizations of people there. I think that's the important investment we need to make. So, from the air-conditioned conference halls, away from the fancy and well-written international instruments that we are all familiar with, that provide the basis for the Civic Charter, it is the precision and simplicity with which this document has been written that could rally the world community to push back the resurgent advent of shrinking political space. So in conclusion, the challenge is for us to make a choice. You can choose to keep quiet, you can choose to dodge, you can choose to reject, but you can also choose to make, you can also choose to be on the right side of history. We believe the Civic Charter, as a Civic Charter steering group, that this simple and concise document can be used to underline the universality of people's demands. It can be used as a tool for awareness raising. It can be used as a tool for education of people's rights to participation. It can also be used for advocacy and campaigns. We know several organizations are planning that, especially where we desire to link people's struggles from local to global levels. At the end of the day, this is my final statement. At the end of the day, whether the Civic Charter is judged as another fad or the crucial missing link is all dependent on what you and I choose to do with it. I am clear about the incredible opportunities that the Civic Charter provides because of its simplicity, amongst other things, and its rootedness in local and international commitments to people's participation. And so, I am on the side that believes that it has been the crucial missing link. You too have a choice, and I believe and trust that your choice will be the right one. I thank you very much. So, thank you. Thank you very much. I will shortly be joined by a few people here. But at this moment, I just wanted to indicate, if you have not had a chance to visit the website where this Civic Charter is resident and several other materials, Miriam is just going to show us. Those are some of the leaders that are expressing their commitment. And you will see if you go down that there is space for you to sign as an institution or as an individual. So we go down, we see the number. We have not yet, marketed this website very much, except in Uganda. So when the website got live, then I really did something in the country. So don't be very surprised when majority of people are from that country. It shows how serious the matter is, but also how determined we are. So I hope that at some, is there anybody in the audience who hasn't signed? Who has, just by show of hand. Okay, great, our facilitator hasn't signed. So for now, while I still have power, I would ask you to take this short walk to Miriam and just sign, okay? As the rest, you just sign symbolically. Because then we hope that on your machines, whatever it is, you can quickly go to the website and sign. And the numbers should be a lot more by the time this meeting ends. Okay. And finally, before the panel comes, I want us to show a four-minute video that we shot in Arusha. And then I can humbly hand over back to the facilitator. So the video, please. Maybe we can switch off the light so that we are clear and listen to the activists and what they said about this struggle that we are on. Okay? Yes.
The Civic Charter is very timely because today, civic space is shrinking at a rate that I haven't seen, at least in my professional life.
The Civic Charter is a set of principles that we believe will galvanize every single person interested in a peaceful, secure, and tolerant world to engage in advancing an environment that can safeguard people's participation.
with this civic charter, there will be a stronger civil society network of solidarity all over the world.
This civic charter is going to be a global framework where people who actually work for the promotion and the protection of the rights can use this as a document that is more acceptable globally, and that provides you the opportunity where you can have a global solidarity in your work while you continue to promote the rights of the people.
The civic charter could help us to have a global instrument to push for more effective participation for civil society.
If we don't have everything that's written in the civic charter accomplished by all the governments, if we can't hold them accountable to it, then why are we talking about democracy? Why are we talking about justice and peace? So therefore, it is a crucial document which brings together civil society to make a statement and create that civic space for all of us.
One part of the civic charter that is very inspiring on our local struggle is the right to assembly, that the charter help us to amplify the voices of those people who are demanding the government to allow the right to assemble.
In Indonesia, from March to June alone, more than 4,000 people are arrested just being on the street protesting the government.
Freedom to form association have been undermined because the government have been introducing a restrictive law, the law on association and NGO. And also, you know, when the citizens are protesting, they often face the harsh crackdown by the government. And many cases that people want to do the protest, the government often come with the excuse that you can't do so because it will affect traffic jam.
We face a situation where the basic rights of people are being curtailed.
The government blocked more than 800,000 websites. And those are informations. A lot of them are very important information for some of the citizens.
Our biggest problem right now is freedom of expression. Because people are in jail for what they believe in. People who are opposing the government, journalists, civil society actors, are in fear of being persecuted through the law.
Things got really bad in many places in the world, including those that we thought were safe and well-run, as in European Union, for example.
If we have legal frameworks, we have political frameworks, and especially freedom of association, expression, that means a lot of elements that could help us to have a real effective civil society participation.
All over the world, activists are being arrested, citizens are being denied their right to participate, and most fundamentally, this denial is actually robbing the world of opportunity for progress. When people don't participate, the world loses the opportunity and the enterprise of its people.
Okay, thank you very, very much. And at this moment, I then invite Burkhard. Yeah, thank you.
And light.
Mm-hmm. Yes, please. Much more light.
Much more light. Yeah.
Thank you, Arthur. That was a great overview of a year's hard work of many people, only four of them sitting here in front of you. And I think we can all be proud with what we have achieved. You have met Arthur. I would like to briefly introduce Annabelle. I said in the break, Annabelle, you are, or you either will be, the boss of most of us here in this room. So she is a crucial figure in our sector. Annabelle is the founder and director of the Communication and Development Institute based in Uruguay. But among her many other tasks, she is at present the chair of Civicus. So you can imagine she looks into everything. Next to her is Harsh Jaitli. Harsh is also a friend of the center for many years, and he is running VANI, a voluntary action network in India, so a big umbrella organization. And you have met Arthur before. What I would like to do is look at the charter in practical terms. So what can we do with it? And just to give you a few examples and then get into discussions how we can best use the charter. Annabelle, you told me a few days ago that sadly you couldn't be part of the launch of the charter in Latin America because it was launched just a day or two ago in Bolivia by some of your colleagues. But I checked with you and you told me, yes, you have heard back from them. So could you tell us, how did the launch go? How did people react to the charter? What do you think they will do with it?
Thank you. Thank you, Burkhard. Good afternoon, everybody. Yes, the first time it was made public, the Civic Charter in Latin America, it was yesterday afternoon in an event in La Paz in Bolivia. And I think it's the topic of the event where the charter was presented says a lot of how it can be used. And one of the strengths of what Arthur was saying, and I'm always insisting, with accountability. It was a public accountability exercise of Bolivian NGOs demonstrating their results, making their resources transparent. And at that event, the charter was welcome, was presented. And as you can read, the principle 10 in the charter calls on our responsibility, the responsibility of governments, of business, and of civil society organizations to be accountable. Because this is a synergy of rights. Yes, we have fundamental rights, but we also have responsibility. And we, civil society organizations, we have to be more transparent, more accountable. In this question of power, we have to learn to share power also in order to be to exercise a more effective participation.
Thank you. Harsh, we have heard quite a bit about India and the situation there, so just building on that. What can an international charter do in a national situation like that? We hear about organizations being labeled foreign agents, and that is an argument against international cooperation. So you could argue an international charter is not a good instrument in a nationalist environment where the nationalists say basically everything which comes from home is good, everything which comes from abroad is bad. So why do you think the charter is still useful as an instrument in your fight?
See, the two things I would like to highlight here in relation to charter. First is that we are in a situation in our country that we are looking for instruments, various instruments, through which we can reinforce not only information to the government, but believe in ourselves that how much, you know, protection we have for our basic fundamental rights. We have seen one example, like the people who are supposed to implement the law, sometimes they believe that the people don't know the law. So therefore, we can do whatever they want. Because in our system, we have seen the interpretation of the law is a very crucial thing. Even though in the constitution you have been given, say, for example, right to assemble. But the person who is sitting in the local police station will define whether you can assemble or not. So his interpretation is final. But somehow, the person sitting in his police station believes that this guy doesn't know what the law is exactly. So what we feel is that, I agree with your point that even our, not only the general public, but even our own sector in India generally believes that things should come out from ourselves rather than coming from outside, like, for example, global standards. We have done a huge exercise in India to adopt global standards, have discussion within Indian civil society. We had a very short launch on 20th in India, and basic thing which was coming was, today this global charter has references to international agreements. What about if we add the constitutional provisions into that? And one example, CHRI is one of the known institutions in India. They did one exercise in telling women about their safety in relation to police arrest and police inquiry. Once that information was given, I think after that, police is very careful while dealing with women. So I think that's why I feel that we need to have such instruments. In 2007, in a very long exercise, civil society along with our planning commission, we developed national policy of voluntary sector, which defines the relationship between government and civil society. That was not implemented at all. But we never lost our heart. We keep on pushing, still we push it that. So I think that is the sum of the instruments we are looking for, which can reinforce the space and the right to this assembly and everything.
Thank you very much. Arthur, you told us before that you took a very special approach to launching the charter. You obviously mobilized your sector, and at some stage we were wondering what's happening in Uganda, because suddenly half of Uganda was signing the charter. Quite fascinating for me was the story. Well, the police are enforcing laws, and sometimes they don't enforce laws, but just power aspirations. And we need to talk about the charter to the police. So you organized a meeting with police leadership. It would be very interesting, I think, to hear how that went and whether that had any kind of results.
Well, we thought about something that would be, in our view, impactful. But also drive the message that shrinking political space and civic space just affects everybody, including the police. The police in our country are the number one agent of repression. They are beating up students, beating up political activists, beating up NGOs. I was arrested one time for speaking against corruption on the streets, you know, distributing flyers. So my experience when I was arrested was very, very rewarding when I got into the police offices and cells, because they didn't remove all of my flyers, okay, that I was distributing as part of the Black Monday movement. And so what happened is on the street when we were picked, you know, we were picked like criminals, you know, with the police cocking up guns and everything. Fortunately, the day before, we had a training on overcoming fear, so I had no problem. I had no problem with that fear. So we go into the police, and every single police officer that came to the room where we were and asked, "What were you doing?" We gave them a copy of the Black Monday, and they said, "We support it. We support this movement. Never worry, you are not arrested. You are not arrested. We have just kept you away for a short time. You will go home. We believe in what you are doing." And the striking thing was that the edition of the Black Monday that we released then, because talking about effective communication, we, as the Black Monday movement, articulate the cost of corruption in monetary terms and the cost in terms of service delivery. So on that day, we had featured the living conditions of the police. They were really in a dilemma. They are speaking about our welfare and we are arresting them. So the reason we insisted that 2 days ago we go and meet the police, because they are human like you and me. When they remove that uniform, they have the same body like you and me. They have the same heart. They think about the world. So we wanted to appeal. The Civic Charter is not a legal instrument. We have enough of those. It is a moral and political instrument that we are trying to engage with. So the meeting went well because we went to the chief, the spokesperson of the police. He was scared. First of all, they are scared when civil society organizations just approach them and they are trying to engage in dialogue. They are used, you know, to just coming out guns blazing and suppressing. But when you approach them from a dialogue perspective, they were a bit shocked. And you say, I have only 20 minutes. But the meeting took much longer. So we had a meeting with the police spokesperson and five other police officers and went through the charter one by one. And they said, this is interesting. I think what I need to do is to disseminate, first of all, this charter to key divisions within the police and organize another meeting on the 3rd of November where my team leaders within the police go through this. So appealing to that humanity, and hopefully they will sign online, and we will inform the International Civil Society Center about if that happens. So on 3rd of November, we have a bigger meeting with many more leaders of the police. I think this is important because it reaches a point. We saw it in Egypt when, you know, you can serve the security establishment with whatever doctrine you have, but it reaches a point where they say, but I think the people have a cause. And so no matter how hard it will be, the police eventually are people. They're not animals. So I think that is the reason why we need to be engaging with them, this not being co-opted, you know, engaging with them when we have to, disagreeing when we have to, and that's what we are trying to do in Uganda.
Thank you very much. And by the way, in case you wonder why we're launching the charter here and you already hear about stories where people use the charter, one of the key issues we had to discuss at the very beginning is who is owning the charter. And clearly, everybody was aware that if it came from the top 10 global branded international organizations, the Amnesties, the Oxfams, and all the others, it would be once again a north-south top-down exercise. And so we were very careful to get a balanced situation throughout the whole process. So we have lots of inputs from all continents and lots of inputs from individuals and from smaller organizations. And so we said, 1 week before the global launch, which is today, we can have launches at different countries. And so some of the colleagues already took the chance. So Pakistan, for example, was the very first country to launch the charter. I think we can be very proud of that. I would hope that others here in this group and others in other countries will develop their concepts and launch them under their terms. Another thing which was important for us when we developed the charter, and Harsh has referred to that already, the charter refers, you can see that in your copies when you go to the orange part of the charter, you can see where it refers to international agreements which most of our governments have signed. So what is in our charter is something most of our governments have committed to, but they opt to forget about that. You could also use that section and refer to your national law if you wanted and say not only have they signed this, but in our constitution or in key laws, we have similar provisions which our government doesn't comply with. And that may be also helpful when you talk with the police. While this international document is there and can't be changed in a comma, you can use it for your national, regional, and even local needs and adapt it as you wish. So we have microphones here, so if some of you want to come in with questions or statements or examples of what they already have done or what they plan to do, feel free to do so. We would like now to go to the next step and say, great, we should launch it as much as possible and make it known around the world. But how do we implement it? So it shouldn't be a document we are all proud of. It should be something which we use as a lever to change the political situation. And so I first turn to my panel here and say, so what are your plans, your ideas of implementing it? How can you use it in your fight to make civil rights in your countries, in your regions, a reality? Who wants to start?
See, as I said, interestingly, some point of time we think that we are mostly, like in India, we have started discussing this, that civil society most of the time we react to the situation. We see that in our country, on the daily basis, laws are being changed. So we react. Once law is changed, then we react. Oh, what has happened? If we see in our situation, my friends from India will agree, that we have in our country a very loose law to regulate civil society. It's of 1860 for registration. But we have very strict law to control. So they want to control, whereas they want to keep the registration loose so that, you know, anyone can open any NGO. Everything is NGO. And then they take that excuse to, you know, punish us by controlling laws. I was thinking, you know, when we started working on this subject, we thought that let that be a document where we say that what exactly we want, what exactly are our rights, and let's disseminate it to the everyone in the country. People should know that the Constitution has given the international community, like UN has given them, these basic fundamental rights which they should protect. Because sometimes we think that it is only government who is violating. But many times we forget that these are our rights and we should articulate ourselves. I will give another example of India. We have this very interesting law, FCRA, very notorious worldwide. Everyone knows it. Definitely it is product of FATF anyway. Now, from the field, those states which are very problematic states, we came to know that the local police comes to local NGO's office and tells them, show us here all the documents. Show us your documents about foreign funding. We asked this question to our central government, that how come the central law has been implemented by a local office? Have you instructed them? They said, no. He said, we have not given that right to anyone to do that. Local police is doing of their own, considering as a local law and order situation. Then we talked to local NGOs and said, please ask this question to those guys who have authorized them to come. You know, simple this information, put them in little bit of, they will think twice again when they come to do that thing. So I feel that this document is a very good document where we can provide information to frontline organizations about their basic fundamental rights.
Thank you. Annabelle.
Yes, they want to stress how timely the Civic Charter is this moment. It's not a coincidence that, for instance, Civicus yesterday launched a tool to track civic space in real time. And the demonstration is that 3 billion people are living in countries where civic freedoms are violated. So we have many things to do. The Civicus monitor demonstrates that there are only, in a scale from open to close, only 9 countries have an open civic space, and the rest, out of 104, have either obstructed or reduced or narrow or just closed. So the question is that this charter is not being respected, that these rights are violated. So there is a lot of work to do in terms of influence, in terms of dissemination, in terms of awareness of the rights of the people, and for decision makers and policy formulators, many things to adopt from these 2 strong pages.
Thank you. Arthur, and after Arthur has given his contribution, I will move to you. So if you have questions, if you have examples how you used or will use the charter, please come to the floor. Arthur.
Okay, thanks. I think that we need to reflect on what would success look like for the charter. And I think there are many ideas that we could share I mean, 1 year from now, I think we are going to come back to that question at some point. But practically, I insist that we've had all these instruments, progressive constitutions, and all that we know are a basis that recognize, they don't grant, they recognize the rights of people. I think the two things we've done and will continue doing practically is to take the Civic Charter and the dimension of public education tool that, you know, behind each and every right or principle or guarantee, we have a backup of several international instruments as well as progressive constitutional provisions. So what we will do in our country is to put these 10 principles out there, and under that, just connect with all the progressive aspects of our constitution so that we take it from global to local. And then people will begin to realize that these are things we must stand for, okay? Put it in the imagination of people. So all the efforts we will have really in Uganda is about taking this to ordinary people to realize that they must be able to claim and push back certain tendencies. The other aspect is to make an effort to connect struggles. So the Civic Charter is not about NGOs only. We know media is struggling. We heard this morning that businesses also have an issue. So if we are able to use the Civic Charter as a rallying document, you know, to connect the struggles so that we are not in different holes, digging holes, but we are connected in trying to get out. Media, NGOs, civil society, political activists, it is possible that within the Civic Charter we find a space to have this conversation collectively. And very finally, I think that the Civic Charter is very important because it also lays us bare, like I said earlier. We are committing through the Charter to also be accountable. So as we advance and demand for greater freedoms, we are also looking inward. Like we say again, I have lots of proverbs from Africa. When you are constructing a port, you don't build the port from outside. You start from inside, modeling it, and then it shapes from inside. So I look at the Civic Charter as another tool that is going to enable us be more accountable to the public, to our constituencies, and to those that we believe we, at the end of the day, are serving and working for.
Thank you. Can we have a microphone here? Over here? Sorry, the first, yes. And the next microphone then there.
Thank you very much, I congratulate on this launch of the Civic Charter over here. Arthur, actually, you mentioned that, you know, people have the choice, but particularly I come from Pakistan and we really don't have a choice. So no choice but to kind of a fight. So in that fight, actually, we will use this Civic Charter, as mentioned that on 17th of this month, the very day that the charter was online, we launched in Pakistan, and it really is well received in media because we had a media launch. It's but at the same time, while we were launching it in the Karachi Press Club, that's the largest press club in Pakistan, at the same time, a political party, that's one of the largest political party, PPP, was having their own convention over there. So when we went over there and we presented this charter to the Central Committee of the PPP, and they have publicly promised that they cannot sign that in front of us, but they will keep it to their steering committee, that's the highest committee, they will discuss and they will sign it. And later on, then we had the internal discussions that we will really pick up from the political parties. So our strategy to kind of get it implemented, to get it signed by the political parties, and we think at least those which are in the opposition now, they will sign it. And we are very much hopeful that the next year the elections are going to be held in Pakistan 2018, and if we are successful to get it signed by some of the political parties which are promising to be in the parliament next, then really will be easy for us to get it implemented. So I was just briefly, that's the one part of a strategy. We have a whole strategy that maybe at a later stage I can explain.
Thank you.
Sure. Samira from Charities Aid Foundation. I have two questions, but I'll make it very quick. One is around the question of solidarity. We've talked a lot about it, and then we've also talked about the shrinking space. It's an old phenomenon. It's an old. It's something that's been happening for a while. It's something that's been happening for a couple of years. It's something that's forgotten and needs to be revived. So I guess my question is, how well are we articulating the value of civil society, even within the sector? Our office on the ground in Russia, for instance, has seen that civil society there is fracturing. Service delivery organizations are distancing themselves from advocacy and human rights organizations. So as a sector, how do we articulate our value internally and externally, and how do we understand the roles that different types of civil society organizations play? My second question is an example of putting the civic charter to use. So in the case of Pakistan, for instance, we had the Pakistan government that basically wanted to put a bid out for a URL filtration system. And basically what this meant was that when you Google a particular site, it says you can't access it. But in this case, when you Google a particular site, it just doesn't show up because it doesn't exist. And so in that case, BOLOP, which means Speak Up, and it's a local Pakistani organization, garnered support locally and then reached out to an international London-based organization. I think Phil Bloomer from Business and Human Rights Resource Center is here, to basically take action. And they were able to convince companies not to bid for this and actually come out for public statement. Where it's gone and stopped now is the fact that a Canadian new organization has bid for it, got the piece of work. And the question is, well, the Canadian government supports freedom of speech. How do they hold a Canadian local organization to account for? So we are operating in new spaces when we think about implementation.
Thank you. So here was...
Thank you. Hello. Pauline Martin from Just Associates Jazz. First of all, it's wonderful to have this, so many congratulations for those that have worked on it. And I see that one of the cases mentioned in the report is Berta Cáceres from Honduras. And I'm just wondering, I mean, in the case of Honduras, we're talking about shadow power, and actually whether, you know, a lot of the violence is instigated by organized crime, by paramilitary groups, and the obviously government turning a blind eye to what these groups are doing. So I just wondered if there were any ideas or any suggestions or any experience of using the charter in that kind of context, and Honduras not being the only case in point.
Thank you. We take a few of those questions together. So next here and then one over there. I'm sorry, colleagues with the microphones, you have long ways to walk. Okay, Sam?
I think one of the challenges, and I first really applaud the charter as a way to sort of capture the whole concept of participation and root it in law and so forth. I think one of our challenges is to get out of the silos of civil society. So this room is largely civil society of human rights, democracy, governance, and development organizations. If you look at the charter, and if you're looking at it from a humanitarian vantage point, the rights of not being bombed by barrel bombs, the right to not be displaced, the right to be protected if you're displaced, all of that's international humanitarian law, which is not mentioned in the charter. So I think our challenge is there are areas of civil society operating outside the democracy and human rights realm that are as concerned about closing space as this community is. And I think in solidarity is going to be the issue of not just participation, but the world's most vulnerable people are the 65 million people who are displaced, refugees and so forth, or the people who are being bombed by the West, by the East, by their own people, by rebels who have their rights not captured in the rights to participate, but the right to be protected.
Thank you.
Thanks. My name is Deirdre de Burka, and I'm here representing a European cross-sectoral civil society alliance called SDG Watch Europe. And this cross-sectoral civil society alliance, really following on from the point that the previous speaker has made, was European civil society's recognition that we needed to mobilize across our different sectors, because even in civil society, we tend to work very much in silos. So we've brought together, and at the moment we have about 70 civil society organizations that belong to this new alliance. And we have civil society organizations from the environmental, the social, the development, the human rights, youth, women, children's organizations, and so on, all coming together to look at the promise that is contained within the new SDG framework, and that is of the right of civil society, along with multiple other stakeholders, to implement, monitor, and review the implementation of this ambitious global agenda and universal agenda. So European civil society and the SDG Watch Europe are going to come together in this alliance to monitor what the European Union is doing, both within the member states and also in its external action in terms of living up to the commitments it's made within the SDG framework. So this, the question of the Civic Charter, is very relevant to us, because we see that it's not just civil society itself that will be involved in the implementation of the SDGs, but we will also have to mobilise communities, citizens, in order to make the promise of the SDG framework a reality. And so therefore this Civic Charter would be a very useful tool for us to use. And I would like to invite maybe somebody from the International Civil Society Centre, or one of the people who've been involved in developing this, the Civic Charter, to actually come to Brussels and maybe to speak at one of our SDG Watch Europe plenary meetings, and to make all of the civil society organisations involved in it aware of the document, and to encourage them to use it in their work. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Gashike?
Okay, thank you very much. My name is Gashike. I come from Kenya, and I'm very happy that I was invited to the first meeting of thinking about involving activists in the Civic Charter. One important thing is that we have a lot of instruments, but this one is like positive values messaging against shrinking civic space. We have a good constitution in Kenya with values of human rights, but at the end of the day, it voted in human rights violators in power who are shrinking civic space. With the charter, it's helped to amplify our voice in the grassroots, and many activists are using it in solidarity. The other thing is that it is possible for the charter in East African region to have a cross-border campaign, whether it's in Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi. It is possible to use this charter to build campaign across the board. So for me, I agree with the charter that it is a positive message against shrinking space, and also an opportunity for social movement to use it as a part of movement building across the region. I don't know why Uganda, Kenya, and Tanzania, we cannot take a message of demanding defense of civic space in East African Assembly. And I think that's why I'm inspired by this kind of energy that is coming in to positive messaging against shrinking space.
Thank you very much. Over here.
My name is Jabir. I'm coming from Civil. It's a human rights NGO in Macedonia, a landlocked country, which is not very important and it's not in your headlines. However, I'd like to say that I'm coming from a country where structural violence is quite well known to the citizens of the country for some time now. We have electoral thefts, wiretapping over 20,000 citizens, including myself, by the prime minister and his cousin, the secret police chief. And we have the investigative custody introduced as a form of punishment of activists and journalists as well, who have been under prosecution schemes of the ruling party for some time now, over 6 or 7 years. And I can only add a few more things, like vast corruption, political discrimination, political corruption, and many other shortcomings of what a democracy could mean and a candidate country for the EU membership. However, this civic charter is quite a challenge for us activists and human rights defenders in Macedonia to promote it, but also to defend it and to make it wide known, widespread, and to give new energy to activists who might doubt about the end of the long-standing crisis and human rights violations in Macedonia. So my compliments to the authors and to all those who worked, and good luck to all of us.
Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Jack from Restless Development. Quick question about the individuals who sign up to the charter. So we find at Restless Development the most trusted voices in development come from within the communities themselves. So when an individual signs up to the charter, are there going to be any tools in place that will help them, support them to raise awareness of the charter, the importance, the value of it, to help NGOs do the same, so that we can build the capacity of other people then to spread that message, sorry, because that seems to be the key to success here, that people are aware of this charter, that will implement it. So yeah, I'm just wondering if there's going to be any tools or support in place for that.
Thank you. So we have one more over here, and then I would like to pass it back to the panel. You have been asked quite a number of questions, so let's see how we can cope with that.
Just a quick one, Tim Parrott from Oak Foundation. I was just interested in the communications and attitudinal change work in Uganda or the launch in Pakistan. We've heard, you know, from vigilantes to a whole sector of broader civil society and the broader disconnection from, you know, the people in the room, our closest allies in human rights or humanitarian or development. Why is it that the values contained in this digest, this succinct document, why is it that it's going to have traction with people outside our usual circuits? So it's that sort of messaging, values-based messaging, which will really connect to people who don't even really understand what civil society is. And if they do, they're suspicious of it.
Thank you. Final comment?
Thank you very much. I'm Adil from Bangladesh, representing Othikar, which is a persecuted organization, in a very difficult country, which is under the carpet now, sitting at the UN Human Rights Council for the third time. But extreme human rights violations like enforced disappearance, extrajudicial executions, custodial torture, and human rights defenders are in jail, including the newspaper editors who are having dissenting voices. But at the same time, it's under the carpet. People don't see it. And with 160 million people, things are getting really, really worse. And people slowly will start moving outside. You will probably in future get refugees more. What I'm interested in, because you talked about silos, breaking the silos. There are organizations which are working with the government, like service delivery organizations. And if they are not working with the government, then they don't have registration. They don't have permission to get their funds cleared, because NGO Affairs Bureau, which is under the Prime Minister's office, controls the fund. You can go out of funds if you are criticizing, like our organization, don't get funds for the last 3 years. So where do you see this unity? Because the organizations which have chosen to become gongos, not silos. Let's talk about gongos. Government-sponsored NGOs or NGOs decided to work with the government. And very few activist organizations which eventually are becoming persecuted. And the actors are keeping their eyes closed and not interested to support them because government might see it as a kind of negative action from the donors, from the so-called democratic countries. So there is the problem. So I'm interested to see that a charter is active for all, but there are challenges. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So I pass back to the panel. Before I do so, I want to make two quick comments. Some of the questions are relating to something we still do not have. So there are no experiences in using the charter because we printed it 3 days ago, or our colleagues just launched it a few days ago. So it's there. But we can't say how it will work. Secondly, we felt it was important just to state our rights. So the starting point was that we said, okay, civic rights are under pressure worldwide. And then the question arose, well, what do you talk about? Who defines what it means in Bangladesh and in Germany and in Kenya? And so we said, okay, let's as a first step basically say, okay, can we agree on a global small piece of paper which says these are our fundamental rights? And obviously there are probably 500 or 1,000 other areas which we haven't covered, and we should have, but we basically focused on in our discussion emerge as the fundamental rights. You are all challenged to develop the instruments to work with this. I don't think we should sort of say look at a centralized exercise here and say, okay, you came up with the ideas and now you need to develop the instruments. I think what we have already heard after this charter exists for a few days, so to say, is organizations who just took it and took it in the way and used it in the way which was best for them. So the charter will be a success if you create the instruments, and then we can be here to basically serve as a crystallization point. So you say, I've got something, I've done that in Macedonia, and it was a good success. And we can basically put that out, and others can say, well, that may be very useful for our fight in Bangladesh as well. So we need to play to our strengths, and our strength is diversity and global reach. So let's all, so to say, do our bits, and let's help each other in getting it done. But don't look too much at us. We're very small, and we are very new, so to say, in the charter. We still need to develop that. Now, I'd like to pass on to my colleagues. Please refer to some of the comments. We don't have the possibility to kind of tick them off all together. And think about this as your final word on this podium. You will have 2 days more to contribute, but we'll need to slowly close this down. Do you want to start, Annabelle?
Yeah, thank you, Burkhard. Yeah, many important comments and many challenges were expressed. I just wanted to refer to the comments about Latin America, and thank you for saying that, because even if sometimes countries in Latin America seem to be open or have some sort of good public opinion outside, there is a variety of civic freedoms that are not respected, that go from the murder of Berta Cáceres to problems in Venezuela 2 or 3 days ago, or the constraints that in terms of funding civil society organizations are facing. And that's also made visible in the charter, that civil society organizations have to be guaranteed funding and financial resources. And that's sometimes expressed when civil society are funded by governments. They lose autonomy, they lose independence, they are co-opted and cannot exercise their rights. So this can be useful in a broad variety of forms. And even if somebody said that Macedonia was not in the headlines, we could also say we're talking that we were only two from Latin America here today, but the region as a whole is in need of this kind of tools, of the kind of body of knowledge that, for instance, the Civicus Monitor and Global Witness are developing. So thank you very much to all.
Thank you, Harsh.
Thank you. Actually, The first thing is that the problem of civil society, especially about shrinking space, is not as simple. It's a complex problem it has become nowadays. And it's not one instrument where we can say that things will improve. I think we need a multiple level strategy at national level, global level, at local level. We need a multi-stakeholder approach, because in many countries, our relationships are redefined. Our relationship with media, with government, everywhere. So we need a multi-stakeholder approach, multi-level approach, and also multiple strategies will work. We don't know what will work in which situation. So I think this can be one, and we can have many, because we are going to discuss this issue in the next 2 days. Many new things will come up, new relationship will build up. Second, my point is about, you know, the Samira's point, a very interesting question she asked. See, the thing is, our new prime minister came with a slogan by saying, happy days are here again. You know, happy days are here. In Hindi, he called it Achhe Din Aage. So after 1.5 years, one journalist asked me that industries have got their happy days. Everyone has got their happy days. What about NGOs? When you will get your happy days? I said, we will not get our happy days. We have never got our happy days. Because the day we will get happy days, it means that we have started thinking in parallel lines with our, you know, same as that of government. Because traditionally, historically, civil society is designed to ask questions. We exist because the last person has not got the basic fundamental things. So when we'll ask question, our ruling elite will become unhappy. So they will not give us happy days. So it's a reality. But within this reality, the unique feature is that the sector has a unique, power, a unique quality of bouncing back. It's like a rubber. You press it, it will jump back. So I think the innovations will come. We will face this challenge. We will face more challenges in future. But our bouncing back strategy is very good. The second point she asked about the difference between, yes, we see very clearly in India that there is a difference between those who work on rights-based approach and those who are into service delivery. Many who were working on rights-based approach have now shifted to the service delivery also. Many donors who were supporting rights-based approach are now supporting service delivery. The things are changing. It's not so easy. For example, sometimes we start feeling, there is a poster I was referring in the morning also. We feel that, oh, this problem is with Annabelle, not with me. I am happy. Like, I have got my FCR renewal. I am happy. Oh, you have not got it. No? You know, something like that. Because I am not there. I have got it cleared myself. So that differentiation is there. Henry smiling. I'm saying something from my heart because I'm sitting in a place where I see all the reactions. But I will give you one example. Last June, government came out with a new law which said that everyone has to declare, especially the board members, all their assets, all their family members' assets. In a publicly displayed, it will be displayed, and everyone has to do that. We called a small meeting before giving petition to the government, and we had money only for 35 people. 250 organizations came up, including business foundations, because they are also their board members are more secretive than us because they have industrial big shots. How they will disclose that, how much money Ambani has. So sometimes, you know, crisis unites us. We work in silos. So when there's a crisis, we come together, then we go back. I think we need to develop some sort of a change in our own attitude that let's sit together when there is no crisis also. Thank you.
Thank you, Harsh.
Yeah. Okay, I think just three concluding points. I think very often, we emphasize what sets us apart. We like to be in our small space and say, I'm different from that one. I'm doing service. But doing service, you're working with the same corrupt government, inefficient, absent state. You know, I am media. I am political party. I am not the other. But if we spend time just thinking about what brings us together, for a common humanity, we will have so much more in common, whether with businesses or people in government or whatever it is. So I think the one important point we need to take forward with regards to silos is to think about what connects us rather than what divides us. And there are many such things we could talk about. The second one is that the civic charter at the end of the day is really going to be an important tool for real popular mobilization of people. That's why I said that it depends on what you decide to do
or not to do with it. If you do nothing, you know, you are not contributing to a cause. But if you do something positive, then we connect the dots and ultimately there will be something positive to talk about. So it's not about asking, what are you going to do? What can I do in whatever, using whatever means I have in my possession? Whether it's talking, whether it's funding, whether it's connecting, we definitely are blessed with all different talents that we can use to make this a success. On the question of the relevance of civil society, I think we can do more. The value, not just the value. We can do more to document what our political, economic, or whatever social value is. But I think a lot of things about civil society, we can't actually quantify. We cannot quantify. It is a feeling, it is a belief, it is, you know. So we need to also realize that not everything can be put in economic terms for us to be able to capture in a log frame. I think what is most important is, are we relevant to people's struggles? Are we really relevant? I think that's part of the crisis we do have. So 4% of people are going to be connected to one civil society or another. But what of the 96%? How do we step down and make sure that this struggle is not a struggle to safeguard our space as organizations, but more to expand the imagination of people to push back? Because I think, and this is my concluding point, the most important frontline and safeguard to civic space is ordinary people who will defend you when you need them. But if you are irrelevant to them, there's no need. There's no need for them to rise up. So if your organization is one of those organizations that tomorrow it is closed and nobody riots, nobody thinks, you know, they just say, oh no, they shifted, then you know you have a problem about your own embeddedness in society. So seek to be relevant, and that is how your space can get expanded.
Thank you very much. I have 2 points to add, which are more, let's say, systematic logistics, if you want to say. Well, you hopefully all now want to sign the Civic Charter. So you have it on your table. It's available at the moment in 6 languages because we excited people who said we translated for you and we don't charge you for that. So I went to Portuguese colleagues and said, what do you think about this? And they said, we'll translate it. So why don't we take it as a challenge to translate it in the next 6 and the next 60 languages? I think that would be useful. In any case, if you want to have it, you can have it. So there are copies you can take with you. There are materials you can take with you. You can have a digital version of it so that you can put it up where you want to use it. And obviously, there are 2 ways of signing it. One is you just sign it outside at the information desk on an old-fashioned piece of paper. The other one, which is even better, is you go to civiccharter.org and sign it electronically. And it would be great if you would tweet about that and encourage all your friends to sign it as well and link up to civiccharter.org. That would be, so to say, optimal if you could do that. I think for us, it will be very important to get as many signatures as possible. Now, this was about you signing as individuals. If you want to sign as organizations, we have to be a bit more careful, so we need to be sure that the organization signs with the proper authority. So if you're a CEO, then you can sign it with my colleagues and we will put it up with your logo as an organization. If you're not the CEO, you need to lobby your CEO to send us an email and say, yes, we hereby sign this. And then you will put your organization up there as well and ideally with your logo. So that is, so to say, the logistics. Now, obviously, finally, I would like to thank the panelists. I think they transferred to you the spirit of our work and their dedication. the steering group, which was much larger than the four of us, and without them it wouldn't have worked. And then we had around the steering group a large group of sympathizers who were there whenever we needed their opinion and their support. So a great many thanks to them as well. And finally, the donors who were crazy enough to work with us. I mean, we're a crazy organization because when we have an issue, we just start working on it and then start worrying about money. It's the wrong way around. It's the wrong way around. So basically, we started working and then we asked around, is anybody able to help us? We need to bring people together from across the world. We don't have the money. And four foundations, Oak Foundation, Wallace Global Fund, Heinrich-Böll Foundation, and the Open Society Foundation came in quickly with small amounts, which helped us to really take this forward. And great many thanks to all of you. Okay, Minu, over to you.
Thanks. Just two things for us to do tonight. One is we're going to have our picture taken. The hope was that on day one we look fresher than on day three. So day one at the end, you know, we might look not so super fresh, but never mind. We're going to gather on the staircase, and I think the photographer set up a ladder to take a beautiful picture of us. And the second thing we need to do tonight is to go for dinner. So if you gather downstairs after we've had our picture taken, center staff will guide you to the restaurant. It's not far from here, but you might get lost. If you know your way around a little bit or have a functioning smartphone, the address, and you want to take the way yourself, the address is in the program. It's called Habel am Reichstag, and it's really not far. It's a two-minute walk from here, okay? But if you rather be safe and not get lost and get fed quickly, you might want to walk with the center staff to the restaurant. Thank you very much, and see you on the stairs.